Andy's next in McCook, Nebraska on 96.9 FM. Hello, Andy. You're on the air.
Hello. How are you guys doing today?
Grand. How can Jimmy help you tonight, Andy?
Well, my question is, does the idea, the teaching of an infallible God, harbor a harmful mindset in people?
Why would it do that?
Well, what I think of is when there's an infallible God, a perfect God, all of the good things in the world must come from him, of course, because he's infallible and perfect. But I can sort of see a line of thinking where if all the good things come from that, and I do see a lot of people teaching that if something bad happens, then you weren't praying hard enough and it wasn't part of God's plan, or, you know, just you weren't trying hard enough because he's infallible. He couldn't have done the bad thing to you. Like, no, it's not that. It couldn't have been failure because of him. So I sort of see a line of thinking in which all of the good things are God's credit. It's his doing all of the good things in your life. And all the bad things are your fault.
Okay. Well, I guess there are a few things to say here. The first one is whether someone would draw those conclusions. The fact is God is infallible. And so people may or may not draw certain conclusions, but that doesn't go to the question of is it true that God is infallible? And the answer is that he is. He's also other things. He's omnibenevolent. He's all good. He's omnipresent. He's present everywhere. He's omniperfect. He has all possible perfections. And so those are all truths about God. And we don't decide what's true about God based on what ideas people might get as a result. If they're getting problematic ideas, the solution is not to water down our doctrine of God, but to help them understand why they shouldn't draw those conclusions. In this case, it seems to me that there may be some confusion about the idea of God being infallible or even that he's all good. Now, one of the big issues in philosophy of theology and in apologetics is what's known as the problem of evil. Why does a good God allow evil? The Christian faith holds that he has good reasons to at least allow it. Since he's all perfect himself, he doesn't cause evil, certainly not moral evil, but he does allow it for various reasons. In the case of moral evil, that is when people sin, they do something morally wrong, we have a pretty good reason why God allows it. It's because without allowing people to have the possibility of sinning, they wouldn't have the kind of freedom, the kind of free will that's necessary to choose to freely love God. And since love is what's at the top of God's agenda, it's the first great commandment is love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. The second great commandment is love your neighbor as yourself. And so love is the thing that God most wants us to choose, but we wouldn't be able to freely choose and genuinely love somebody if we didn't have at least at some point the ability to reject love. And so rejecting love and acting in an unloving manner is precisely what sin is. And so consequently, God allows sin, he allows moral evil in order to allow the possibility of freely chosen authentic love. Now, it's a little different when it comes to physical evil. Physical evil is something, you know, like when you stub your toe or when something physically painful happens or even mentally painful. But physical evils are not in the same category as moral evil. They can actually produce good. I mean, that's why we have pain receptor nerves, is to alert us when we are in a dangerous situation and we need to do something to address it. So you stick your hand in a fire, it hurts, and that tells you very quickly you need to do something to get your hand out of that fire. And it even happens can happen on a reflex level. And so physical evils can be things that God uses in a different way. He may tolerate moral evil, but it's not objectively wrong for something physically evil to happen, and so that can play a different role in God's plan. Consequently, when I look at the things in my life that have happened that are bad, some of them may be because some of them may be physical evils, in which case they may be doing a good either for me or for someone else, or God could compensate me for them in the next life. It's not necessarily anybody's fault immediately. It may just be something that God allows to happen, but on balance, I'm coming out to the good, so I can live with such evils. Or if it's a moral evil, it's the product of somebody's free will other than God's. He may tolerate them doing it in order to allow the possibility of love, but it's not something that I have to take the blame on myself. If someone does something morally evil with respect to me, let's say they hurt me in some way deliberately, just to hurt me, well, okay, that's sinful. They shouldn't do that. But it's not God's fault. It's not my fault. It's their fault. They're the one who abused their free will. So the fact that God is perfect in these ways doesn't result in the conclusion that if something bad happens, it must be my fault. It can be for all kinds of other reasons, and it's overly simplistic to try to reduce it to, well, if it's not God's fault, then it must be mine. There are lots of other possibilities there, and so that's an overly simplistic answer.
Andy and McCook, Nebraska, thanks for the call.